The Philippine government finalizes the implementing rules and regulations of the new law for public-private partnership projects. We have more from Jackie Pascual.
The Philippine government expects more public-private partnership or PPP projects now that the implementing rules and regulations of the PPP Code has been signed. The National Economic and Development Authority and the PPP Center say the new law will strengthen and institutionalize PPPs in the country. It also creates a unified legal framework and clarifies some issues surrounding the Build-Operate-Transfer Law.
PPP Code provides clarity to many of the ambiguous provisions of the BOT, and so it makes the governance of PPP now clearer, and so it's more predictable, so the private sector can be more incentivized now to get into PPP.
Officials add the new law will entice more companies to invest as the process would be clearer and faster.
Project approvals in PPP projects, which used to take a year for some project, has now been capped at 120 days max. Otherwise, the project will be deemed approved.
There is also a provision on unsolicited proposals and a timeline on whether to approve or reject it.
The implementing agencies will act on it. Kasi dati, if they don't feel like doing the project, parang itatabi lang dyan, di ba? So, unfair din to, for the private sector to have spent resources putting together an ANSOL, tapos, you know, it's in limbo for years and years.
Balisakan adds that many projects also do not need to get NEDA board approval, especially small PPP projects in the local government level, which do not need any form of government subsidy.
Many of the projects that used to go to the NEDA board for approval may no longer go to the NEDA board for approval because the threshold has been increased to 15 billion. The LGUs also would have their PPP projects no longer have to go through all the way to the NEDA board.
The NEDA secretary asserts the country needs more investments to increase its potential growth, which is now at 6%.
Based on the resources we have, based on the environment, based on the institutions, based on our policies, what we are seeing is the economy has a potential for 6% growth. No, it's about a medium-term potential. Now, of course, we are eyeing for last year, we eyed for 6.7. This year, we would want higher than that, right? But 6%, that's quite a significant improvement in that potential GDP growth.
Balisakan says in order to elevate the potential growth, there must be more investments in infrastructure and human capital. The PPP is one growth driver. Currently, of the 185 infrastructure flagship projects worth over 9 trillion pesos, 45 are PPP projects. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Economic Zone Authority reports a 19% jump in investment approvals in the first quarter of this year to nearly 15 billion pesos. This covers 50 new and expansion projects. The projects are expected to bring in $616.6 million in exports and 11,558 in employment. Most of them will be in export manufacturing as well as ITBPM. Geographically, though, majority of the projects will be in Quezon, Taguig, and Makati cities, Calabarzon, Bataan, Pampanga, Cebu, Albay, and Cagayan de Oro. While top investments came from the Cayman Islands, Hong Kong, Singapore, Philippines, and Japan. PEZA is confident it can hit its target this year of 202 billion in investment approvals. That would be a 15% increase from 2023 levels. A semiconductor group bullish about the industry's potential to enhance trade ties with the European Union following Marcos's trip to the Czech Republic. During the chief executive's visit to Prague, he signed three deals aimed at unlocking collaboration opportunities in the IT and semiconductor sectors. The Semiconductor and Electronics Industries in the Philippines Foundation, or SEIP, says these deals will lead to an increased trade relationship in the Eurozone, where the Philippines has yet to maximize those opportunities.
The intent really is to promote trade. As you know, the electronics industry is the biggest commodity exporter We accounted for about 62% of our exports. And the thing about it is that, you know, Asia and U.S. are our main export destinations, main trade partners, but we don't have that much in Europe. The biggest ones are in Netherlands and Germany. And so the Czech Republic is a good opportunity, and we were invited to join the president to sign an MOU. And in fact, after we signed the MOU, that was last Friday, we've already had inquiries from Czech companies looking for potential partners in the Philippines. So it bodes well for our industry. Last year, we contracted, the industry contracted by about 8%, so we've gone from $49.3 billion of exports down to $45.6. And so since it's a global market, what we try to do is promote our products, promote our capabilities all over the world. I mean, yeah. Asia and U.S. were strong, but we're weak mm-hmm. in EU. And so the president's trip really opened the gates for EU.
The Philippine Tax Bureau expressing its full support for the rationalization of the mining fiscal regime. The move aims to simplify the tax system and ensure the government's fair share in mining revenues, plus establish good governance in the mining industry. During a Senate hearing Thursday, the Internal Revenue Bureau also made suggestions for easier tax compliance and administration.
Fully supportive of the rationalization of the mining regime, as it will simplify the taxation mechanism on mining agreements. However, the same with the Department of Finance, we are recommending for fewer tiers and rates, as it is in keeping with the principle of administrative feasibility for easier compliance and administration.
Now, despite growing tensions in the West Philippine Sea, Beijing and Manila's trade relations remain intact. Chinese Ambassador to Manila Huang Silian says China continues to be the Philippines' largest trading partner, with two-way trade hitting $40 billion last year.
China has been the largest trading partner of the Philippines for 8 consecutive years, and investment in the Philippines has also maintained rapid growth, making it one of the largest sources of investments. Despite different national conditions and systems, we pursued similar development goals, complement each other's strengths, and have enormous potential for mutually beneficial cooperation.
Huang also highlighting Beijing's continued economic growth and his country's role in global development. He adds China wants inclusive globalization, which allows different countries to participate in economic and social development. Marketing and data analytics company Kantar says a lifestyle shift among Filipinos has increased their spending on fast-moving consumer goods last year, with certain categories seeing a very healthy recovery, from healthy foods to personal and home care products like facial wash, nail polish, paper towels, and other cleaning products. According to its Outlook 2024 report, Filipinos will remain positively cautious this year as inflation and GDP numbers improve. They will continue to look for value in every purchase, but will not be limited to affordable brands or smaller packs. They also continue to seek an omni-channel experience. Data show almost half of local households shopped across 6 to 8 channels, from sari-sari stores and grocery stores to supermarkets and e-commerce websites. Meanwhile, snacks and non-alcoholic beverages, which comprise the bulk of out-of-home purchases, will continue to see an uptrend. Pets, too, should enjoy a lot of love from fur parents allotting budgets for their food and grooming. Education Department accredits the first Philippine overseas school in Cambodia's Mekong region. The certificate has been given to the Philippine International School of Phnom Penh, which will now teach DepEd's curriculum to its students. Vice President and Education Chief Sana Duterte is in Cambodia, where she met with her Cambodian counterpart and visited different schools there as part of her duties as Council President of the Southeast Asian Ministers of Education Organization. Duterte says the Philippines can also learn from Cambodia in enhancing the education sector.
Nakita natin na pwede nating tutukan o tingnan yung kanilang teacher training. Dahil meron silang teacher training program reforms na ini-implement ngayon na gusto din, yun din ang pakay natin doon sa atin sa Pilipinas dahil meron ngang kakulangan yung quality of education natin. And isa doon ay yung teacher factor natin.
Quezon City now requiring all restaurants and food establishments to display the calorie count of their menu items, while other nutrition information such as carbohydrates, total fat, sugar, and sodium, among others, will be made available in printed materials or in an electronic platform upon the customer's request. The calculation of nutritional requirements must be done by a Food and Drug Administration accredited laboratory or a registered nutritionist dietitian. The ordinance, though, exempts micro, small, and medium enterprises, and there are many of them. Violators will face as much as 5,000 pesos with their business permit at risk of being revoked. Based on data from the Quezon City Health Department, almost 1 in 5 adult residents in the city have high blood pressure. In 2018 alone, nearly 20% of school-aged children and 43% of adults were found to be overweight and obese. More pain at the pumps again. A big-time oil price hike looms next week. Estimates from the Energy Department show motorists would have to shell out as much as 2 pesos and 10 centavos more for a liter of gasoline, while prices of diesel and kerosene are expected to jump by as much as a peso and 50 centavos per liter. The DOE says a Ukrainian attack on 3 major refineries in Russia is one of the major causes for the increase as it heavily impacted petroleum supply. Citi's online app and website shutting down following Union Bank's acquisition of its banking operations in the Philippines in 2022. Citi announced on its website, users will lose access to the mobile app starting 7 p.m. today, March 2022. However, customers can still access their accounts by downloading Union Bank's online app and setting up their Union Bank online profile. Citi Philippines Facebook account was deactivated on March 25th. A company co-founded by tech tycoon Elon Musk demonstrates the successful use of a brain chip implant, which has enabled a paralyzed man to move computer chess pieces with his mind. Take a look.
Noland Arbaugh is playing this game of chess with his brain, using a chip implanted by Elon Musk's startup Neuralink.
I'd like to introduce you to the first ever user of the Neuralink device.
The company live-streamed the event on Wednesday. Arbaugh, in January, became the first patient to receive a Neuralink implant, which seeks to enable people to control a computer cursor or keyboard using only their thoughts. The 29-year-old was in a diving accident 8 years ago that left him paralyzed from the shoulders down.
Do you want to explain a little bit what's going on here?
Yeah, so I love playing chess, and so this is one of the things that y'all have enabled me to do, something that I wasn't able to really do much the last few years, especially not like this. I had to use like a mouse stick and stuff, but now it's all being done with my brain. If y'all can see the cursor moving around the screen, that's all me, y'all. It's pretty cool, huh?
Actually, can you pause the song just for the audio coming through? And that was also done with your brain?
Yep, it's all brain power up there.
Arbaugh said that while there was room for improvement with the new technology, it had already, quote, changed his life. Former program director for neural engineering at the U.S. National Institute of Health, Kip Ludwig, said what Neuralink showed was a, quote, good starting point, but not a, quote, breakthrough. Last month, Reuters reported that U.S. Food and Drug Administration inspectors found problems with record keeping and quality controls for animal experiments at the firm. Those findings came less than a month after Neuralink said it was cleared to test its brain implants in humans. The company did not respond then to questions about the FDA inspection.